William Morrow and Harper Audio present Noumenon Ultra, a Novel by Marina J. Lostetter. Performed by Celeste Ciulla. The missions thus far. In the late 21st century, subdimensions were discovered, which allowed for new relativistic travel that bypassed the constraints of light speed by diving into a pocket of alternate physics. This, along with prevailing peace and stability across the globe, paved the way for the Planet United Consortium, a space-focused, scientific conglomerate featuring contributions from nearly every country on Earth. They developed the Planet United missions, 12 deep space convoys, each with separate scientific goals. The majority of these convoys were crewed by clones. Each mission had its own quirks and unique configurations. This is the story of two of those convoys. Convoy 7, the only convoy with an interactive, personality-driven AI, known as ICC, the Interconvoy Computer, connected throughout the ships. Seven focused on a strobing far-off star and whether or not its unusual behavior was due to an alien construct nearby. No extraterrestrial life of any kind had been confirmed prior to the convoy's launch. Convoy 12, the littlest convoy, which was to remain closest to home. Its crew consisted both of clones, grown for the POMs, and of non-clone Earth-based personnel. Its mission was to further study the subdimensions, looking for more efficient means of travel. Convoy 7 found its alien construct, dubbed the Web. They assumed it to be an incomplete Dyson sphere, meant to slowly siphon energy from the star. Part of the convoy set out to finish construction and activate the device. Another part split off, becoming Convoy 7.5, mission name, Noumenon Ultra, to seek out information regarding the Natare, the alien civilization to have most recently worked on the Web, though not the megastructure's inventors. Convoy 12 was the victim of a subdimensional accident that launched it into an unknown SD, which propelled portions of the convoy approximately 15 kiloparsecs away from Earth. It took them only a moment to traverse the distance, but over 100,000 years passed on the home planet. When they re-emerged in normal space, they encountered what they assumed to be an advanced alien convoy. Both missions' assumptions were wrong. Once activated, the Web began traveling from star to star, consuming each before moving on to the next. Convoy 7 now believed it to be a weapon. And when Convoy 7.5 returned with reports of several other star-sized megastructures and knowledge of an ancient interstellar war, their theory appeared confirmed. Rejoined, both halves of the convoy set out to annihilate the very thing they'd built. A last-minute decision by one intrepid captain, with help from the AI, prevented the machine's destruction, allowing the Web to finally reveal its purpose, that it was not a device bent on devastation, but creation. It used the materials gathered from the stars to build a life-supporting solar system. Convoy 7 named one of the system's planets after its original mission, Noumenon. Convoy 12, with no knowledge of what Convoy 7 had discovered, being now many tens of thousands of years removed from those events, was shocked to discover not only varied versions of intelligent life forms, but also a construction field of star-sized devices. The convoy's interactions with the life forms, which they named the Lung, were strained, bordering on hostile. After their accident, Convoy 12 needed vital support to sustain itself. The life forms offered minimal aid and barely any communication. The Convoy 12 crew members were left bewildered, After all, they'd never envisioned aliens having an attitude of mild disinterest in a first contact scenario. It wasn't until an away team retrieved a sampling of Lung DNA that they discovered their assumptions and framing of the situation were all wrong. This was not first contact. It was a homecoming. Humanity had greatly evolved over the thousands and thousands of years they'd missed. Bio and mechanical engineering had transformed the human as well as the human experience. The beings the Convoy 12 crew had thought alien were, in fact, the descendants of Convoy 7. And what they'd interpreted as disinterest was actually caution, awareness of a delicate situation. From the Lung perspective, the Convoy 12 crew were ancient remnants of humanity's past, in form and in understanding. And yet there were strange evolutions aboard Convoy 12 as well. The accident that launched them across the galaxy and into their future left them with other ailments. A single baby who'd never awoken, who was perpetually an infant even after 14 years. A woman out of time, who jumped in and out of an unknown SD without a bubble whenever her sense of anticipation mounted. And convoy-wide infertility, meaning not only were they relics of ancient humanity, they were also the last of their lines. But all was not lost. The future may be strange, but it had a place for them. The discovery of dozens of alien megastructures throughout the galaxy had spawned new endeavors, new human civilizations, and new religions, as many post-humans labored toward uncovering the overarching purpose of these giant artifacts. The Lung turned over the fate of Convoy 12 to a religious leader, the Progenitor, who the crew were shocked to discover was a modified clone of a man they'd known, ICC's inventor, Jamal Caden. He told them of a place their prospects could brighten, a planet where the schematics of ancient human genes were housed, a place where they might find the proper tools and information to develop cures for their new ailments. Noumenon. And so a small group boarded the Progenitor's ship and set off for this megastructure-created planet, ready to take their next steps toward a new day. But the past has a way of making itself relevant again. Long-forgotten events and tidbits of information, minor footnotes at the time, prove to have great significance. People face losing themselves when they lose their history and forget the things they've seen along the way. The discoveries made by Noumenon Ultra continue to reverberate down through the ages. What the small branch convoy found those millennia ago may still have bearing on the measures of tomorrow. Part 1. Reliance. Prologue. Ivan. Mad World. Aboard Convoy 7.5, mission title Noumenon Ultra, prior to the activation of the web.
Ivan.
Ivan only vaguely recalled that his name was Ivan. In the dream, his name was a sense of reach, of mental touch by another dreamer. He'd been told his name, the word, the letters, the sounds of it, when he'd first joined the dream. Only a few weeks out of the tank. Cloning tank to dreamer, one womb to the next. He'd been studying Natare records just now, while letting an emotive symphony swell through him, reading a book that two other dreamers were currently writing and rewriting in real time as he read, and allowing the sensation of soft kittens to travel over his fingers. He liked blue, and all of his world was blue today. But there was that annoying sound again. One he heard with his ears, not in the dream. Was today? No, it couldn't be, not yet. Had his time to be caretaker come already? Why hadn't the current caretaker come to him in the collective? Why hadn't they prepared him in the dream? Ivan! His limbs convulsed. His real limbs, the ones attached to his actual body. Everything tightened, everything pulled. All his muscles contracted at once. He could sense his skin stretching around the anchor bolts that kept the exoskeleton screwed solidly to his bones. Things twisted. His spine twisted. He wasn't supposed to be able to feel his spine. His eyes opened. Air. He could feel the air on his eyeballs, and it was unnatural. It was dark all around, thank the ships for small favors, but there was a shape right in front of him, too close. It was blurry and pale. Everything was blurry, he realized. His eyes hadn't tried to focus for years. Taking stock of what he could, he noticed he was standing, his exoskeleton held upright by the hydraulics and wires attached to tracks in the ceiling. There were other figures nearby, as they should be. Their bodies played out scenes here in meat space, letting their muscles work, their bones and organs experiencing some level of stress. It helped keep them healthy on the inside, which was all that mattered. Last time he'd had his eyes open, he'd been in a group of other children. Their exoskeletons playing a wires and tubing friendly version of leapfrog. A group of autons had settled him into place, their robotic faces blank, but their touch gentle. They were consciously guided by other dreamers, of course. The crew still had to perform in the real world, and they did it through these extensions. How else could they obtain samples and records when they visited new locations on the Natare map? But all the intellectual work was done in the dream. The Autons had been transferring him into his adult exoskeleton that day. The last exoskeleton he'd ever need. At some point in his life, he'd been transferred out of his first small exoskeleton into his toddler exoskeleton, and then into increasingly larger ones to fit his growing form. He had teetered on the edge of awakeness each time, but had never fully reached it, and he couldn't remember most of the configurations of the crew around him, what mime of a task they'd been performing. Though the dream made memories clearer, he had trouble settling on which memories were his. The dream was collective. The dream was all. And the younger he was when a memory was formed, the more like everyone else's memories it seemed. Ivan wasn't sure how old he was now. Fully grown, though, for certain. He'd been able to do 3 lifetimes worth of professional study so far in the dream. That was why the crew had given up meat space, after all. The dream made so much more possible. Fully grown and fully capable. And now he had to face a responsibility he'd always dreaded. Ivan, said the pale shape again.
I think you're supposed to call me Dr. Baraka, he tried to say.
Tried. But his mouth had never fully formed words before, and his tongue was underdeveloped and clumsy.
Donna try to speak, not yet, said the shape.
There was a sharp creak as the shape moved. Hands came up to Ivan's face, drew back his lips, looked at his teeth.
Not a grinder, good.
I'm not supposed to be awake yet, not for another year in real time at least, Ivan tried to say with his expression, but his face felt stiff, skin too taut. Why not come to me in the dream first? Why am I awake?
You are confused, the shape said.
Slowly, Ivan's eyes were adjusting. He could see the outline of a face now. He might see more if the person backed up. They were so close, his eyes nearly crossed, trying to focus.
I see the confusion, but I couldn't inside, everyone knows all at once.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.